It's time for the Phil Ferguson Show.
This is Phil Ferguson, and you are listening to The Phil Ferguson Show. Going to be a little bit of a short show because I'm actually on the road right now in the West Coast. Depending on the day that you're listening to this, I'm either on my way or already at the FFRF convention in San Francisco. So today, the interview is a best of interview. It is with an author who wrote and researched all about Alcoholics Anonymous, so you're going to want to definitely listen to that. And the Investing Skeptically segment is a newer segment, not newer, brand new, and that's on dividends. Had a lot of questions recently about dividends, so you'll have the Investing Skeptically segment, brand new stuff, and then the interview is going to be best of, a nice fun topic on Alcoholics Anonymous and its 12-step program, and does it work? Does it work for some? Does it work at the rate of chance, like a placebo? Is it worse than doing nothing? I guess you'll have to hang out and find out. And if you're out there at one of these conferences, I hope to see you there. So we'll just go into our segments, and I hope you enjoy. This Investing Skeptically segment is about dividends, stock dividends, and or bond dividends. For some reason, I've gotten quite a few questions on this recently via email. And of course, if you have something that you'd like to ask a question on, send it to me, phil@polarisfinancialplanning.com, and I'll do my best to answer it. I think I answer all the emails that I get, but every once in a while, someone points out that I didn't. So my apologies. If you don't hear an answer from me in a couple of days, at most a week or two, email me again. I won't be offended. I won't be bothered. I'm at the point where I think I can answer all the emails that I get. We're getting close to where maybe I can't. I don't know. But for now, I think I can. We'll see how the holiday season and the tax season works out. Next spring, it might be rougher for me to answer something then. But I've gotten quite a few questions about these dividends. So one of them is, do you set them up for automatically reinvesting? Okay, this is tricky. So for most people, if you have particularly a smaller account, like let's start with something under $50,000, and you're young, you're not close to retirement, you're 15 years or more from retirement, and you have under $50,000, and you have the Vanguard Total Stock Market Index, which is my recommendation. If you wanted to go with the Vanguard Total World Index, I'm not going to fight you for it. That's okay. You put it in one of those two funds, and you turn on the automatic dividend reinvestments. Why not? Set it and forget it. Piece of cake. If you only have two or three funds, you can do the same thing. When you get a larger portfolio, there is an advantage, I think, mathematically, historically, to having multiple funds that have limited correlations to each other. You can get a really dramatic example between stocks and bonds often, but even within stocks, as an example, in the last 12 months, ending September 30th of 2018, the Vanguard Large Growth Index Fund made 22.67%, a wonderfully large amount of money. And the Vanguard Midcap Value Fund only made 9.43%, 22.5 versus 9.5. That's a big disparity over the last 12 months. What will happen going forward in the next 12 months? I have no idea. However, using this philosophy of regression to the mean, those funds, as well as all the Vanguard index funds that are generally based in the stock market or segments of the stock market, in the long run, I think they're going to make around 10%. So in that case, if I'm adding new money, I want to add it to the one that's underperformed compared to the rest. And maybe I want to, as I've been doing, trimming from the one that's overperformed. You can do that with new money. You buy the one that's underperformed, or you can do that if you're in retirement by taking out from the one that's overperformed. You can also do that with the dividends. So if all of your stock and bond investments pay cash, or the dividends stay as cash, they're not automatically reinvested, you can use that money as a way to buy into the things that are underperforming. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense if you're in retirement, because you should just take those dividends out, so you don't want them to automatically reinvest. If you have a taxable account, automatically reinvesting can kind of lock you in a little bit, because when you want to rebalance your portfolio, you are compelled to sell something. And that gets into a whole nother thing. I could do a whole show topic on this. When you sell something, you can pick and choose not only which fund that you want to sell, but you can pick and choose which purchase date, which lot, which group of shares that you bought on a certain day. And you can kind of regulate your taxes, some people more than others, based on what you bought and when you bought it, even within the same one fund. But generally, you don't want to do a lot of thrashing around, because every time you buy and sell, not only is there possibly a transaction cost, which is usually very small, but you can create tax consequences. When you do those adjustments in a taxable account, you're probably going to pay capital gains, which again is not really a problem, because the capital gains tax, unless it goes away, and I don't see that happening, you will have to pay the capital gains tax someday unless you die. That's really the only way to avoid the capital gains tax. If the government decides at some future point capital gains tax is zero, I think that would be stupid, and I would be opposed to it philosophically from an expense income position of the government and the services I think it should provide. However, if capital gains rates go to zero, you will hear me recommending very vigorously that you should sell everything. You should sell everything and wait a certain amount of time and then buy stuff back, because you'll reset your cost basis to a much higher level. But anyway, anything short of that magical event happening, which I would be philosophically opposed to, you will have to pay some capital gains. So you just have to pay it now versus in the future. And, you know, you can rebalance your portfolio. But you can do some rebalancing, small rebalancing, with the dividends. So for me and for my clients, I have almost always all of the dividends set to go to cash. And it's a trigger to help me review the accounts, because as cash builds up, a few thousand dollars, I look at it and go, why is there cash here? And then I can look at the portfolio, and if the balancing that I need to do is small, I'll do that with the cash. If the balancing becomes bigger, I might have to sell something and buy something else. If it's all inside of IRAs or Roth IRAs, and it's not that big of a rebalance, I'll probably just do it, because I have discretionary authority with my clients' accounts. If it's in a taxable account, and I want to sell 50 or 60 grand in something that might cause $4,000 or $5,000 or more in a tax bill, we're going to have to talk, because I don't want someone calling me next March upset that they had a $5,000 tax bill that they didn't know about. So we'd have to talk about that. But basically, the dividends, if it's a simple account, if it's a few positions, if it's a smaller account, yeah, set them all to automatically reinvest. You have a lot of time, and it's more important to get the money to work quicker. If you're a few percentage points off of the plan that you have, it's not a big deal. You can adjust or not adjust. But when you get closer to retirement, you get a larger portfolio, I'm much more inclined to have the dividends go to cash and use them as part of the rebalancing. If you're close to like 5 years or less or in retirement, that cash is going to be the first place you're going to go to get money, unless the market goes up a whole bunch. I mean, if you have a case like this last 12 months where the large cap growth went up 22.5%, I'm inclined to sell some of that. So if you have a $1 million portfolio, and let's say you have, $200,000 in that position, and it went up 20%, it added $40,000. If you need $50,000 out of your account, I might take a good chunk of that 50 grand right out of that one position. It also turned out that the small cap growth went up 23.5%. So that's a great position. Other things, not so much. So we do the rebalancing by selling something in your retirement. If we have a year where the stock market is down 25 or 30%, then we can sell a bond position. Even if the bond made minus one or plus two, minus one is way better than minus 20. So you want to sell from the winners. That's part of the overall philosophy. But dividends, that's how you do it. The other question that comes up is, are the dividends taxable in an IRA or a Roth IRA? No, they are not. All of that is deferred out into time. And so for an IRA, you have no tax consequences from selling. You have no tax consequences from dividends. They just add to your account value and it goes up, 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 up. If it's a traditional IRA, you avoided taxes when you put the money in. So everything you take out counts against your current income tax rate, I guess, is the way to say it. So you might have to pay 22 or 24% on current tax rates if taxes go up some point in the future, and or your portfolio gets even bigger, you might pay 30, 35, even 40% tax on all that money that you take out. So something to be aware of. If it's in a Roth IRA, it compounds tax deferred and tax free because you paid all the tax on the money going in. And I often put in the little caveat based on current rules. I could see people getting wacky and at some point in the future saying, hey, wait a minute, someone put in $10,000 to the Roth IRA 50 years ago and now it's $100,000 and they've never paid tax on any of that. It wouldn't be a completely illogical thing for them to say you should pay capital gains on it at least 10 or 15% depending on your income level. That's not the current rules, but maybe someday in the future that changes. So dividends, basically small accounts. If you're younger, yeah, automatically reinvest. It shouldn't be a very complicated portfolio, two, three, five investments, automatically reinvest, keep an eye on it. When you add money, the money you're adding should be a bigger percentage. So if you have a $50,000 portfolio and you add five grand, you can rebalance with the new money. So you don't have to sell anything. Go ahead and automatically reinvest. If your portfolio gets larger, say $1 million, and you're adding $5,000 or $10,000, that $5,000 or $10,000 might not be enough to rebalance the portfolio. So have the dividends go to cash. It doesn't change your tax liability. If it's in a taxable account, you're going to have to pay taxes on them, whether they're reinvested or not. So think about doing that. And that's some of my thoughts on dividends and rebalancing and reinvesting stuff all kind of mushed together.
He loves you and he needs money. He always needs money. He's all powerful, all perfect, all knowing, and all wise. Somehow, just can't handle money. Religion takes in billions of dollars. They pay no taxes, and they always need a little more. Now, you talk about a good bullshit story. Holy shit.
Everybody, welcome back. This is Phil Ferguson, and you are still listening to The Phil Ferguson Show. Today we have Dr. Lance M. Dodes, and he is extra special because he and I already recorded the show, but it turned out the connection wasn't good enough via our phones, so now we're using Google Hangouts. So give him a little extra love and consider extra hard buying one or more of his books, because we're doing this a second time just for you, the listeners. Dr. Dodes, how are you today?
I'm fine, thank you. Thanks for having me.
That's all right. We broke the fourth wall there, if you know your acting terms. We do that all the time here. Now, what we had talked about before is you are a specialist in addiction, I guess. Is that fair to say?
Sure, yeah.
And for our listeners, you have three books available at all fine bookstores, and of course my favorite, Amazon, because they ship it to me and I don't have to leave the house and talk to normal people in the world. One is called The Heart of Addiction. We also have Breaking Addiction, and the new one, which we'll focus on a little later, The Sober Truth. And how is it you come to write a book, or three in this case? What motivates you?
Well, I actually am a psychoanalyst, and I became interested in trying to understand what makes addiction tick psychologically many, many years ago. And what I discovered was that there were a number of interesting ideas about it, all of which had some merit, but I was interested in trying to put them all together because they were different. Hoping I could find a kind of a unified theory to explain all of them. And I started writing about that in academic papers back in 1990. And by the time 2002 rolled around, I wrote my first book, The Heart of Addiction, to describe what I had discovered about the nature of addiction. And then in 2011, I wrote Breaking Addiction because I wanted to give people a kind of handbook. It's a little shorter than The Heart of Addiction, and it's arranged in a step-by-step fashion so people can use some of these ideas for themselves. And then last year, my colleague and I wrote The Sober Truth about AA and the statistics for it, because AA is by far the most commonly prescribed approach to alcoholism. It has an extremely bad success rate, so I thought that was important to get out to the public.
Oh, it absolutely is, and we'll tease the listeners with that data, knowing that it's out there, and we'll get to that in a minute. But can you go over a little bit of the background of where AA came from and how did it get started?
Well, AA was invented by Bill Wilson, who was a stockbroker, in the 1930s, and he wrote the book Alcoholics Anonymous in 1935. And Bill Wilson was a member of a group called the Oxford Group, which was a fundamentalist Christian group that started in England in the late 19th century. And their belief system was taken from first century Christianity, and it was very simple. It was the ills and the problems of mankind are due to being distant from God. So the closer you were to God, the less you will suffer various ills and misfortunes, including addiction. So he was a member of the Oxford Group, and he wrote that he took the 12 steps of AA directly from them. And the 12 steps are, as you can see from the steps, they're just a reflection of that you should turn your life over to God or a higher power and follow the precepts of goodness and take a step four is called a fearless moral inventory. So you take a moral inventory of yourself, and you want to purify yourself, basically, so you're closer to God or a higher power, and that will help you with your addiction. Along with that, the theory of addiction was that it was a spiritual disease. That's what Bill Wilson believed. Of course, there's no evidence for any of this, but that was the idea of it. And when AA got started in the 1930s, it was widely criticized by the medical establishment and by everyone, really, because it was obvious what it was. It was just an extension of his religious ideas into the addiction field. But then something strange happened, which is the followers of AA, the ones who were doing well, became kind of zealots, and they began to say to everybody, if you work this program, you will get better. And in the 1940s, the most popular columnist in the United States was a man named Jack Anderson, who probably is more or less forgotten today, but he was extremely well-known throughout the country. And he wrote for the most popular magazine in the country, which was the Saturday Evening Post. And he wrote in the 1940s, he wrote a famous article, which was a glowing piece about AA and about all the people it had saved. And this, along with the fact that the folks in AA were all proselytizing, because that's part of it, they go out and tell the world how good it is, made people think that AA really was the answer. So from then on, it was more or less a continuous a belief system in the United States that AA was a wonderful treatment and the best treatment, until you get up to today when most public addiction treatment agencies of government are run by AA people, and they are, you know, their treatment program is AA, and nearly all of the rehabilitation programs in the country are 12-step programs. And I believe, I'm not sure of this, but someone told me that the current drug czar in Washington is also an AA member. So the power of AA has become, is enormous, and people, they still believe the original statistics that Bill Wilson actually made up, which were that almost everybody who joins becomes a sober member. It's completely false, of course. But so that's the history of AA in a nutshell. AA has changed its, well, first of all, it's hardly changed at all. I mean, although medicine and psychology and everything else in the world has changed vastly since 1935, AA hasn't changed at all, which means either they got it right to begin with or they're way behind the times. But they have changed the ruling, the way they talk about the higher power, so that there are atheists in AA and there are people with all sorts of religious beliefs. And so it is common now for them to say, well, it doesn't have to be God. It could be a doorknob. That's your higher power. But God is mentioned several hundred times in the book AA, and 25 states in the U.S. have declared that AA is a religious organization. So it certainly stays close to its roots. And one of the ways that that affects it is that since every AA group is independent, anyone can form an AA group, they vary enormously. So there are some AA groups that are quite thoughtful and open-minded, and there are some AA groups that are fundamentalist and harsh, and you either buy the whole system or you're evil. So that's the story of AA, except for its outcome studies, which I guess you want to get to later. But
we'll do that after our upcoming break a little bit. You have, and you talked about this in the book, and again, for the listeners, in case you missed it, it's called The Sober Truth, is the new one about AA. You have this inherent selection bias because the people that succeed go out and brag about it and promote it and try to spread, dare I say, the gospel of AA. And those who fail are drunk and have problems getting their lives together and are often told that they are the fault, that it's the reason is that they didn't do the program. Is that correct?
That's exactly right. And one of the AA slogans that has been the most harmful is, it works if you work it. And it's been extremely harmful to people for the reason you said, because it tells people who don't benefit from it that they haven't worked hard enough. And, of course, that's completely false. I mean, we've all known people who have worked extremely hard trying to get something out of AA, and they can't. So it's a kind of a slur on anyone who doesn't benefit. But the other thing is that, as you said, when people don't do well in AA, they blame themselves because AA blames them. It's not the individual people who are so cruel, but it's the system. If you don't, it's supposed to work if you work it. So they say, do more of it. If it's not working, do more meetings. Do 90 meetings in 90 days. They never say, you know, AA isn't for you. Go try something else. It's completely different from any professional organization. It's not a professional organization. But one of the costs of that is that where a professional will say, look, what I have to offer you is not the best thing for you. Let me refer you to someone else, or let me give you a different treatment. AA doesn't refer out. They refer in. So the result is that people waste years and decades of their lives going back and back and back to 12-step programs, either AA or to 12-step rehabs, without getting better, and their lives are destroyed, and they feel worse about themselves. And the people who care for them, care about them, criticize them. You know, they say, you failed. It's never that the treatment fails.
Well, it does worry me that the very first thing you have to do is admit you're powerless. I mean, step one is to admit you're powerless. Second one is a higher power. And then, of course, third generally acknowledges that higher power is God. And so if you don't have any power, I don't know. That to me, that seems like a broken philosophy. How am I going to fix it?
But I guess they teach that you're not going to fix it. God is, and you have to, you know, like you said, you know, work it. And if, and it's kind of like a dogmatic religion. If you have troubles, if you don't have enough money, you just don't have enough faith. Is that kind of the analogy we're making here?
Yeah, I mean, the it's a whole system. So you're right. The step four, the what so-called fearless moral inventory, is supposed to be something that you're supposed to work at. But the very fact that it's moral already gives it away. I mean, there is no reason for a person with an addiction to make any moral inventory of themselves any more than the rest of us need to. You know, it's not, addiction is not a moral problem. It may result in problems for other people or yourself, but it's not a spiritual moral insufficiency. It's a psychological symptom. And so when people say work it, they mean do what we tell you to do. As far as the powerlessness goes, you're right. I mean, I've always felt, and it, in my approach to understanding addiction, it's quite the opposite. What you need to do is to learn enough about yourself and about how the addiction works in you so you can control it rather than it controlling you. It's the opposite of being powerless.
Well, and then to continue on this religious thing, step six, it says we're ready for God to remove these defects. And seven, we ask God to remove our shortcomings. So, you know, it goes back to, if you aren't fixed, you've done something wrong up to this point, and you've got to start over. And that's why they talk about, you know, going the 90 meetings in 90 days, show up every day, go twice a week. It's just more and more and more. Because God is all-powerful. It's always your fault. You're doing something wrong. And I think that builds, even for the people that it works, possibly a new dependency on AA or the religion that it promotes.
Well, I think that, you know, if there, for those people for whom it works, I think we would all agree, and they would agree, that better to have to go to AA meetings for the rest of your life than to be drunk and have your life ruined by your drinking. But again, the problem with it isn't that for the people, for that small percentage of people for whom it works. The problem is that the vast majority are being harmed by being told they should go there when it can't work for them.
Now, I know in your book, about two-thirds of the way through, you had some personal stories, and I know the names are changed. One of them was Sharon, who was in her early 20s, and she talked about her her boyfriend. I don't think they were a sweetheart, she called him. And he went through this process of evaluating and, you know, trying to go make amends to everybody that he knew and cared for, and he was doing that. And I guess at some point he reached a point that he'd fixed everything he could fix. He'd evaluated everything. He had accepted that he was powerless, and then he killed himself.
Mm-hmm.
And she talks about how she was trying to talk to the family, and they kept telling her, you just don't understand how AA works. And in this case, at least, it kind of masked the symptoms of suicide, the steps that someone often, I mean, everybody's different, often go through before they commit suicide. He was doing very similar things under the guise of AA, and no one seemed to notice.
Yes, there's that. And then, you know, I don't know this individual who killed himself, but it's also possible that, and this is because this is quite common, that he tried his best to do the steps, and he discovered that it didn't make him feel any better. You know, it didn't solve the problems of his life. The original Oxford Group philosophy, which is get closer to God and follow God's precepts and become as morally good as you want, and then your life will be fixed. He discovered that wasn't true. Of course, it's not true for practically everybody, and you know, so he gave up.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. What I'd like to do is we'll take the commercial break, and then we'll talk about data and real science when we get back. So if you can hang on, we'll do that. Listeners, don't go anywhere. Listen to these important commercial messages, and we'll be right back. All right, everybody. Welcome back. This is Phil Ferguson, and you are still listening to The Phil Ferguson Show. Today we have Dr. Lance Dodes, and he's written three books on addiction, and his newest one is, of course, specializing in Alcoholics Anonymous, and we were talking about the history and some of the problems with it. Let's talk data. You're saying it's not particularly effective? I mean, what is it, like 50-50?
When we wrote the book, we looked into every study we could find, every academic paper up through the publication of the book. Book came out last year. And we went back 40 or 50 years. And the bottom line is that the success rate for AA is between 5 and 8%. So of all the people who go to AA, between 5 and 8% on average become sober members. And this is the result of a lot of studies. In 2006, a very famous group called the Cochrane Collaboration did their own review for the past 50 years of studies of AA effectiveness. The Cochrane Collaboration is a group of 30,000 scientists worldwide, and they are widely regarded as the definitive group to study the what is good science and what is bad science. Because what they do is they pick an area to look at, in this case it was addiction in 2006, and they review all the studies, and they vet them. They throw out the studies that are scientifically invalid, and they look only at the studies that are scientifically valid. So what the Cochrane Collaboration found was that if you look only at good science, they couldn't find any evidence for the effectiveness of 12-step programs. And, importantly, they also couldn't find any evidence of the effectiveness of the professional version of AA, which is called 12-step facilitation treatment, or TSF. And the reason that's important is because TSF is the so-called professional treatment that is available in almost every single rehabilitation center and many addiction clinics. What TSF is simply getting people into AA. That's what it does. It's 12-step facilitation. So they couldn't find any evidence of any effectiveness. But we know that it is, in fact, effective for the 5 to 8%. So we also looked beyond the 2006. We looked at all the newer studies. And we wanted to especially look at the studies that seemed to say, that did say, that concluded that AA was a good program and everybody should go to it. We looked very closely at those, and that information is all in the book. But those studies were all plagued by terrible, horrible scientific errors, and the worst one of which was they ignored their own data. You can't do that in science. So, for example, one of the studies that is maybe the most cited study for trying to show the effectiveness of AA ran for 16 years. So that's one of the reasons why it's considered important. It was a long-term study. And the authors concluded that because the people at the end of 16 years who were in AA were doing well, they said, aha, this proves that slogan, it works if you work it, stay in it. Unfortunately, what they failed to pay attention to was that 83% of the people in their study had dropped out. And so they were drawing their conclusion on the basis of the 17% who stayed. And they themselves admitted that the reason the people dropped out was because AA wasn't helping them. So they were doing something that was circular. They said, if you look only at the people who are doing well and therefore stay in it, they do well. It's circular reasoning. And they took that small percentage of people and they said, since they are doing well, everybody should stay in AA. It's exactly backwards reasoning.
That is amazing. I think if some pharmaceutical company was testing a new drug and 83% of the people dropped out of the study, no one's going to consider that to be a valid result, are they?
Well, nobody would. That's right. But addiction is a very strange field. It's been dominated by people who like AA, including the researchers, by the way. And so they bend over backwards to make it sound good. I mean, that's a terrible thing to say, but if you just look at the numbers, that's true. In some cases, actually, they're being paid by the by the rehabilitation centers. I'll talk about that in a minute. But it's horrible. One of the things we did in our book was we put back those people. We said instead of throwing them out as if they had never existed, let's put them back in the data. And we tried to put them back in several ways. We tried to be as fair as possible, bend over backwards to make a favorable version of it for AA. But no matter how you did it, it actually reversed their conclusion. It said what they should have said, which is, if you are doing well, then stay in it. If you are among the vast majority who don't do well, get out. That's what they should have said.
Yeah, so, I mean, like a medical treatment, I'll go back to that analogy. If it's working for you, for whatever reason, you find camaraderie or compassion or friendship or some kind of regular schedule, and it works for you, go ahead and stick with it. We're not saying everyone should not do it, but to blame the 83% for failing and to say the program works for everybody is obviously not the case. I guess one of the questions I have is, what happens if I don't go to AA and I do nothing?
Well, there is a spontaneous remission rate for alcoholism. That is, what happens to the people who get no treatment at all? So that has been studied. The spontaneous remission rate for alcoholism is 5%. So, in other words, if you look at people a year after you start a study, a year later, the people who got no treatment, about 5% of them just stopped drinking altogether, just with no treatment at all. That was one of the ways that this that supports one of the studies that supported this actually was in the 1990s, the largest study ever done to look at the effectiveness of treatment was called in the United States was called Project Match, and it was called Project Match because they were trying to match treatments to individuals. The success rate of treatment for addiction has always been horrible. So they said, well, maybe it's because people aren't getting, they're not being treated with the right approach. So what they did was they looked at three different treatment approaches. One of them was TSF, in other words, 12-step treatment. One of them was something called motivation enhancement therapy. And the other one was cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT. And what they found after they did this massive and very expensive study was that none of the treatments were effective. They couldn't find an effect. In fact, they found that the people with no treatment at all did just as well. So this, from one standpoint, the study was a complete failure. They couldn't learn anything about matching. From another standpoint, of course, to a true scientist, all data is important. It doesn't mean even if it doesn't prove your hypothesis. And it showed how ineffective all of these treatments were. From my standpoint, I was unhappy with the fact that none of these three treatments were the kind of treatment I would have recommended to begin with, because although not everybody, there is no magic bullet, but the sort of thing I have been writing about for the past 25 years is about trying to understand people with addictions as human beings, that they are people who have a symptom. Their symptom is a compulsion to drink or a compulsion to use drugs or a compulsion to clean their house or a compulsion to eat or a compulsion to gamble. These are all compulsions. We call some of them addictions, but they're all the same, basically. And we know that's true because people switch back and forth between them. People switch from alcohol, a compulsion to use alcohol, to a compulsion to gamble. 40% of compulsive gamblers are alcoholics, for example. And they switch to other kinds of compulsive behaviors, like having to clean the house or watch the internet and so forth. So it turns out it's a completely understandable psychological symptom. Doesn't make you crazy, doesn't make you different from anyone else, in fact, and it can be worked out. Not everybody can do that, but it's a treatment they didn't even look at in Project Match. So, yeah, so there is, it is curious that the spontaneous remission rate is similar to the AA success rate.
Yeah, it's kind of... It's like a placebo. Some are going to get better no matter what you do, including AA.
Yes, and some people, I think you said it exactly right. When people do get better in AA, it is because it's supportive. There's a comradeship. Any group that identifies itself as a separate group will always have some people who do well in it because of the support, the shared structure, the shared belief system. When people are in a group like that, it's very helpful, especially if your problem is that you feel overwhelmed and you feel you need to take a drink. You are kind of empowered by taking the drink or by doing the drug. You're no longer helpless. Well, for some people, if you're a member of a group, that helps a lot with feeling helpless. You know, and that's true in general. So it turns out that AA doesn't really have a sort of secret special sauce. But when it does work, it's because of the general properties of groups, which explains, I think, why it's helpful for the people that it is helpful.
Now, you had alluded to these centers where people can go and get treatments, and it was a good chunk in the book. Why don't you tell us about that a little bit?
Yes. The rehabilitation industry is basically a fraud, and I'll tell you why I say that. In the 1980s, when the very first major rehab center was started at Hazleton in Minnesota, and it's a 12-step program. They became very rich very quickly because people thought, you know, I'll go away and I'll get cured. So very soon after, many other rehabs started up, and they still are in competition with each other. So since they are all 12-step programs, they really couldn't say we have a better treatment than the other program. So what they started to do was they added these other features, so-called, which have nothing to do with treating addiction, but which are very expensive. So, for example, all of the high-end programs, which, by the way, cost between $30,000 a month and $90,000 a month, what you're getting for your money is beautiful settings, gourmet food, horse therapy. They all offer horse therapy. Horse therapy is, believe it or not, being around a horse. What this has to do with treating addiction is not clear. But they offer this equine-assisted therapy. They offer various magical therapies, I can't even tell you what it is. You're supposed to get an immune response from Qigong therapy, which is another fraudulent thing. Anyway, they compete with each other by adding these non-treatment treatments and by being very expensive. My favorite is Passages Malibu, which is where all the celebrities go. It's $90,000 a month, and one of the things you get for your $90,000 is Passages owns its own yacht, and you can get a ride on their yacht, which is called the Safe Passage. And the way they justify this nonsense is they say, as an addiction treatment, is they say, well, if you get a ride on a yacht, it gives you a sample of what life is like when you're not drinking. And I'm not making this up. Yeah. So the tragedy of this is that people believe this nonsense, and they spend their hard-earned life savings going to these extremely expensive places. And then when people don't get better, which they don't, when they come out, it repeats the same problem with AA, which is it's always the patient that gets blamed. They didn't work the program hard enough. They didn't come out and use what they learned. And so very sadly, people who do not have a lot of resources then scrape together some more money, and they send them back to the rehab. And it's a terrible tragedy. So now,
I could see
what I recommend. Yeah, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, so what I recommend is this. Sometimes people do need a timeout. They need time to get away. First of all, they may need time to detox for a few days to get off the drug physically. But sometimes people need a little bit longer to get away from their environment and to, you know, have some drug-free time. And in that case, what I recommend to everybody is find a place that is the shortest, not the longest. Because don't forget, 30 days, there's nothing scientific about a 30-day stay. 30 days is meaningless. It came about because for a while, that's all insurance would pay for, and so that became the right number of days to be in the hospital. But I would look for a program, if you have to go in, that is closer to 10 days, and I pick that number because those programs do exist, 10 to 14 days, if you have to go in. And pick one that has minimal frills, because they'll be less expensive. And don't forget, the success rate is the same. The success rate for these fancy rehabs is terrible, and the success rate for the short-term rehabs may be no better, but it's no worse. So
yeah. So instead of paying $50,000, you can do it for $10,000.
You can exactly, and that also means that if you really do need another break another time, you could go back to that place and it wouldn't cost you as much. But let me just say, and the other thing you should do is try to find some place close to home, because people travel across the country to these major rehabs, and even if they like it there, and they make a relationship with the counselors, they lose that relationship as soon as they go back home 2,000 miles away. So it's a bad idea to be far from home. Stay where you are, where you can integrate that with an outpatient follow-up. But as far as the outcome data, there is almost zero data on rehabs. That's because the rehabs either don't bother to follow up, or they don't want to publish the information that they've got. But we were able to find one piece of data that was published by Hazelden. And what it showed, first of all, the study had exactly the same problem. They ignored all their dropouts. But when you added back all the dropouts, what it showed was that about a third of the people coming out were drinking again by 3 months. About half of them were drinking again by 6 months. And they were mostly drinking by a year. And of the people who were mostly, they were almost all drinking again, and a lot of those people were drinking quite heavily. So what the people who wrote the study wrote in the understatement of the century, they said, the treatment effect seems to wear off over time, which means that it really, as for a lifelong problem like alcoholism, it has a terrible outcome. So, which is not surprising, because the treatment, it doesn't consist of anything but AA itself and a couple of sort of not very professional groups.
Absolutely. Now, there's several secular organizations. I'm thinking of Rational Recovery and Secular Organizations for Sobriety. Any news on those? Are those better?
Well, I think the key is that since we know the success rate of AA, of 12-step programs, and by the way, it's the same for Alcoholics Anonymous or Gamblers Anonymous or Narcotics Anonymous, they're all exactly the same. Since we know the success rate for that is poor, if someone tries them, they should make sure, as I said, that they get out, because the likelihood is enormous that they won't be helped. So, unfortunately, we don't have data on the other programs. They don't publish data. But if you are the sort of person who wouldn't want to go to an AA program, then of course you should start out, if you're going to use any self-help program, by going to something like SOS, the secular sobriety program you mentioned. There's a program called Life Ring, which is also secular. There are harm reduction programs. Harm reduction is an excellent idea. It's not an abstinence model. It's not that anyone is against abstinence, of course, but for those people who can't become abstinent, at least they can reduce the harm from their behavior. And there's an online organization called HAMS, H-A-M-S, the HAMS Network, which is a harm reduction network. There are programs, there are rehab programs that are harm reduction programs, which are useful. Smart Recovery that you mentioned, which is what came out of Rational Recovery. Smart Recovery is also an alternative that people can use. And finally, of course, there are people who can use psychotherapy, which is what I've been working on most of my career. It's not for everyone, and there aren't always therapists available in every community. But, you know, if you're going to end up spending $30,000 to $90,000 on a rehab, on the whole, you're much better off and it's much cheaper to go see a really good therapist and try to work out what leads you to have this problem. As I say, especially in my second book, Breaking Addiction, is a step-by-step outline for how to think about this. And I always emphasize when I talk about therapy, you do not need to have all the problems of your life worked out to stop drinking, say. Far from it. Often the addictive behavior ends relatively quickly, even though you may want to stay in the treatment to work out the reasons behind it. And there's a way to approach therapy that does that, and that's what I've been working on for most of my career. So it's not that you have to, you know, spend 25 years on the couch. It isn't that sort of thing at
sure.
all. But you want to find somebody who is not an AA person and you know, who will talk to you like you're a human being who has something that needs to be talked about.
Well, we're getting long in our time. And again, of course, I thank you for doing this with me a second time. It's greatly appreciated. And hopefully people can get some benefit. Where can people reach you or you know, where should they go to read more about what you're doing?
Well, there are several ways. I have an online blog, which is free. It's actually on my website, which is lancedodes.com. But it also appears, and it also appears on Psychology Today. I have a blog there called The Heart of Addiction, which is the same as the name of my first book. Either way, the blog on my website is, I think, a couple of blogs behind. The Psychology Today is up to date, but I will get my website up to date soon. And then, of course, there are the three books that I wrote, The Heart of Addiction, Breaking Addiction, and The Sober Truth, and those are all available on Amazon. You mentioned they're available in bookstores, and it's a little spotty because bookstores are, I've learned about the bookstore business, and they won't keep a book on their shelves unless it is selling rapidly, because they'll replace it by something that will sell more rapidly. But all of the books are on Amazon, and they're all paperback, so they're not expensive. And I think they're all now available in a Kindle edition too. So if you're a Kindle user, I think you can just download it. And I think at least the Heart of Addiction is available as an audio book as well.
Great. Well, thank you once again, Dr. Dodes, for coming on the Phil Ferguson Show. And hopefully a few people have heard this, and they're going to try to seek out some more help and make their lives better. But thanks once again for being on the show.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
The longer you live, the more you look around, the more you realize something is fucked up. Something is wrong here. War, disease, death, destruction, hunger, filth, poverty, torture, crime, corruption, and the ice capades. Something is definitely wrong. This is not good work. If this is the best God can do, I am not impressed. Results like these do not belong on the resume of a supreme being. This is the kind of shit you'd expect from an office temp with a bad attitude. And just between you and me, in any decently run universe, this guy would have been out on his all-powerful ass a long time ago. And by the way, I say this guy because I firmly believe, looking at these results, that if there is a God, it has to be a man. No woman could or would ever fuck things up like this. So...
You're listening to The Phil Ferguson Show.
Again, thank you very much for listening to the show. If you can think of a topic that I should cover, let me know. You can send me an email, phil@polarisfinancialplanning.com, and I'd be happy to talk about it or maybe just answer your question. If you're looking for an advisor, I am available. I do, unfortunately, or fortunately for me, I guess, have a minimum requirement of $500,000 for your portfolio. If all of that money is in your current employer's 401k, unfortunately, that won't count unless you're planning on leaving, because I won't be able to manage it. I won't be able to get paid. So it's kind of a weird thing. But if you have questions or if you just want me to look at your 401k briefly, you may still contact me. Again, the email is phil@polarisfinancialplanning.com. Hopefully you learned everything you'd want to know about Alcoholics Anonymous. And of course, I do appreciate you listening to the show and telling your friends and doing a 5-star review. You can do that at iTunes and Stitcher. That's the only two places I know of. If you come across another place, please let me know. I hopefully can see you somewhere out there on the road at one of these conferences. Until then, ciao.
Yeah. When I walk on by, people be looking like Manny's whack. I pay to the beat, walking in the street with him being free, yeah. This is how I roll, living in the world so out of control. This guy's love running through my mind, and I'm so deep in love, I praise him all the time, yeah. Hey, look at my buddy, just look at my buddy. Hey, look at my buddy, we work hard. Hey, look at my buddy, just look at my buddy. Hey, look at my buddy, we work hard. When I walk in the world, this is what I see. Blessings raining down as I'm falling to my feet. I got a passion in my heart, and I ain't afraid to show it, show it, show it, show it. I'm blessed and I know it. I'm blessed and I know it. Yeah, when I worship God, all my pain fades until my body falls. And when I seek his name, the Holy Spirit falls, I swear, so insane. What? This is how I roll, worshiping his name until I lose control. We're headed to the heavens, no time for waiting, no pain, no gain, and I still keep patience. Whoa. Hey, look at my buddy, just look at my buddy. Hey, look at my buddy, we work hard. Hey, look at my buddy, just look at my buddy. Hey, look at my buddy, we work hard. I walk in the word, this is what I see. Blessings raining down as I'm falling to my feet. I got a passion in my heart, and I ain't afraid to show it, show it, show it, show it. I'm blessed and I know it. I'm blessed and I know it. Check it out, check it out. Do it, do it, do it, do it, do it now. Do it, do it, do it, do it, do it now. Do it, do it, do it, do it, do it now. Do it, do it, do it, do it now, now. Make the change, man. Just make the change, man. Yeah. I'm blessed and I know it. Hey. Yeah. Hey, look at my buddy. Just look at my buddy. Hey, look at my buddy. We work hard. Hey, look at my buddy. Just look at my buddy. Hey, look at my buddy. We work hard. I'm blessed and I know it.